in hell, in torment, was utterly unexpected. He lived a comfortable life. He wore wonderful clothing. He ate the finest food. He no doubt had great friends, had parties with them, had a wonderful life. And one fine evening, he went to bed in what was no doubt a very comfortable bed and fell asleep. And to his great surprise, he woke up, so to speak, to find himself dead and in hell. That was undoubtedly a shock and a big surprise. But there were more surprises yet to come, because being in agony, being tormented by the flame, being on fire, he desired some water, just a drop of water, to quench his thirst and cool his tongue. And he looked up, where could I get water from? And then he gets his second big surprise, because there was Lazarus. Lazarus, that old, filthy beggar, that dirty wretch, covered in sores, that he had certainly never had any use for previously. Now, he's no longer a poor, filthy beggar, but there he sits in paradise, in all comfort and in all joy. What a surprise, and not a very pleasant one. The Lord tells us this parable, brothers and sisters, this parable of the rich man and Lazarus this morning, so that we might not ourselves have an unpleasant surprise waiting for us. The Lord tells us, be careful. Don't let your hearts be weighed down with carousing, with drunkenness, and the cares of life. For that day of your death, will close in on you suddenly like a trap. There's another story that came to mind when I was writing this sermon, and it's a story about a surprise, another big surprise that happened in the Bible. A story from the Old Testament. Some of you may remember that there was a great prophet in the Old Testament called Elijah. And, or sometimes in the Orthodox Church we call him Elias, Eliah or Elias, but Elijah is his normal name in English. So the prophet Elijah, he's the one who ascended into heaven in a fiery chariot. And his disciple who witnessed this was the next prophet, the prophet Elisha. And there's an interesting, several quite interesting stories about the prophet Elisha. But one of the strangest ones, and most, almost, I dare say, entertaining ones about the prophet Elisha. At the time when Elisha lived, there was a king in the area of Syria and the king of Israel. And the king of Syria and the king of Israel were not on the best terms, shall we say. And so one thing that the king of Syria really wanted to do was go down into Israel and make raids and loot, pillage, and kill people and things like that. Have lots of fun. So the king of Syria would occasionally send out a secret raiding party into Israel, but every single time he did, there would be an army of the Israelites waiting to stop them as they would try to sneak in. And so the king of Syria said, well, something is wrong. I must have some traitor in my council. So he called his counselors and his generals together and said, which one of you is betrayed? I'm telling my plans, my secret plans to the Israelites. And they said, O king, it's not one of us. It's not our fault. It is the prophet Elisha. The prophet Elisha sees and knows your plans. Even if you talk to yourself in the privacy of your bedchamber, he knows exactly. exactly what you're saying. And the prophet Elisha goes and he tells the king of Israel exactly what you're going to do, and then they can stop you. So the king of Syria said, well, we must go out and kill the prophet Elisha. We must get rid of this troublemaker. So where does he live? He said he lives in the city of Dothan right now. So the king puts together a small regiment, and they depart in the night, and they go to the city of Dothan, and in the night they surround the city, and when the people of Dothan wake up in the next morning, they find themselves besieged. And Elisha, the prophet, is there, and he looks out and he sees the army. Now what would you do if you were in Elisha's position? What would you do? Elisha came up with an interesting plan. Elisha lifted up his hands and prayed to God and asked the Lord to send darkness and blindness on this army. And the Lord did. Suddenly the army of Syrians became blind and in the dark. And Elisha marched out the city gates, marched into the camp, and said, let me tell you, you're in totally the wrong place, but I know where you need to be, I know where to lead you, I know who you're looking for, and I will lead you right to the person that you're looking for. And so this Syrian army, blinded, starts following the prophet Elisha down the road, and they march another 10 miles to the capital city of Samaria, where the king of Israel and his army are. And Elisha led them right through the city gate and into the marketplace. And when they were all assembled there, he lifted up his hands and he prayed to the Lord that the Lord would lift this darkness and blindness from them. And suddenly, they opened their eyes. And there they were, right in the marketplace of the city of their enemy, surrounded by the king's army, each soldier with a drawn sword or a spear, and they knew they were in trouble, said the leader. And the king of Israel looked at Elisha and said, Father, what shall I do with them? Shall we kill them all? And Elisha said, no. You must give them breakfast. So they made a great feast, and they fed the Syrian army and gave them drink and sent them back to Syria on their way unharmed. Now, those soldiers were certainly very blessed to have had the prophet Elisha there to not only play this trick on them, but to save them. But I have no doubt that those soldiers, for the rest of their lives, probably woke up in the middle of the night in a cold sweat, thinking about what had almost happened. And the reason I mention this surprise is because this is this image of opening your eyes and being surrounded by your enemy. This is an image of what happens when the wicked die. They open their eyes and they find themselves surrounded by their enemies, the demons. And that is not where you want to be, because the demons do not have pity. They have no mercy. Indeed, this is not what the Lord wants for anyone. Not what the Lord wants for us, certainly. The Lord desires everyone to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. And he wants us to come to the bosom of Abraham, where Lazarus was, if we will but listen and go where he is pointing. We desire to have our eyes open and our mind open to the teaching of our Savior, and our eyes and ears open the teaching of the church. We want to spend this time of our life wisely, I mean with love for God and love for our neighbor. Indeed, one of the great lessons of the parable of the rich man and Lazarus is that God puts people into our path for a reason. And when God puts in our path someone who needs help, we need to try to help as much as we can. Certainly there are some limits on our help. We can't help so much that we do damage to ourselves, grave damage to ourselves. You don't want to get yourself into a position where you help someone so much that it destroys your peace and it destroys your life. But nevertheless, if God puts someone in our path that needs help, then we need to reach out to them. We need to have our eyes open to see people who need help. You know, the rich man, he saw Lazarus every day, but he never really saw him. His eyes just passed over. And that's how it can be so easily with us. We want our eyes to be open to see those people that the Lord puts in our path, that the Lord in his providence brings to us. Just one more surprise. It was a great surprise for Lazarus to look up and find himself in paradise. He was amazed, no doubt, to see that he was no longer surrounded by dogs licking his sores. He was no longer filthy. He was no longer sleeping in the street. He was amazed to look around and find himself not only in paradise, but to find that paradise was more joyous and more beautiful than anything he had ever even imagined it to be. And so with us, my brothers and sisters, we have been called to a heavenly homeland. And no matter how great our anticipation, no matter how much we think about it and try to imagine, every imagination we have about it will be surpassed. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man to conceive of those good things that God has prepared for those who love him. So brothers and sisters, may we each be blessed to receive that joyous surprise in the kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Christ is in the midst.
Amen.